and then you will define your budget based on that. Okay, so let's dip down and discuss in more details. So sales forecasting and its relationship to the operational planning. So the sales forecast is a prediction of future market potential of a specific product. So here is we are saying the market potential of a specific product. So every product will have their own specific market. Every product will have their own specific customer set. So what we are doing is we are checking and predicting the future market potential for a particular sales product. So what is a future market potential? So future market potential is a quantitative estimate of in either physical or in monetary units of the total sales within the market. So what is the available sale consumption? For example, let's say we can normally you might have here the pharma industry is $2 billion. So what is the meaning of $2 billion? Is the market potential. How much you can sell in total in that particular market to that particular customer in for that particular product. So it can be monetary terms, means in the value terms, or you can sometimes say in quantitative terms, how much physical quantities can be sold. So that is market potential. So how you decide the market potential? You have any idea how to estimate the market potential?
Maybe wrong, event, but it's way,
Mm.
I'm not the same person.
Mm.
So I think we must know where we are. What is our position, brand position, or our company position in this market, right?
Yes.
Then, what we have a marketing plan. How to benefit the market? How to?
No, but that's you are talking only about your own company only.
Yes,
Here we are talking about the entire market. So how you are going to estimate the entire market? For
Oh,
example, let's say penicillin. Maybe you can say what is paracetamol, for example. This is a pharmaceutical, right? Paracetamol is a general drug used for fever, correct? So it can be used by anyone,
Yes.
bigger, smaller, older, younger generation, male, female, doesn't matter, right? So let's say we are talking about Myanmar. So how will you estimate how what is the market potential of Myanmar?
For our company, we as about we have Jamie Saturn. We want to know market potential of Jamie Saturn. We start from the means, MIS.
What is MIS?
The data with the book record, especially pharma market. From that data, we selected.
So what data you select?
From most of the Jeremy Sutton competitor market, from our potential, how much?
So but that is already done.
Yes.
So but how they do it? You need to understand that. So how will you do it? Let's say, okay, let's take the example of paracetamol. How much is the Myanmar potential, Myanmar population at this point of time? How much? Like 50 million? Correct?
Okay.
50
How can
million?
we know the sales?
We will go there, don't worry. Let's say the market potential of the, so let's say the Myanmar total population is 50 million. How many percent of them would get sick in a year?
Data analysis or the
So
business analysis.
basically, you need a previous market analysis. Maybe in the last few years, in all the government hospitals, in all the private hospitals, how many people are admitted? Let's say you said, okay, 2 million people were admitted, right? So now you say, okay, maybe around every year, 20% of the people get sick in Myanmar, correct? Now, how many of them will go to, now this way, you need to redefine again. How many of them will need a paracetamol? Or, so because they need, what is the level of sickness? Because paracetamol is not given to everybody, right? You give to only a certain category of fever, or you get viral flu. You are not giving it them. So what are the categories of the sickness? So in that particular, let's say you are giving paracetamol for what? Flu? You give them or not?
Yes.
For flu. So let's say how many
Cobra Spark for painkiller one.
So let's say how many of them get sick by flu? Maybe out of this 20%, maybe let's say the 20% is 10 million, right? Out of them, another 20% gets sick by flu every year. So that makes 2 million, correct? Now 2 million get sick by flu means everybody of them need a paracetamol, and everybody need at least 7 pills, maybe a week, correct? So it means you are having a potential of 14 million pills that you can sell. It doesn't mean you will sell. It doesn't mean only paracetamol brand will sell. Can be anything, but that's the market potential. Means you can sell if all the sick people take the prescription on time, you will be able to sell 14 million. Now let's assume maybe some of them will not go to the doctor because they will feel they will use the herbs or homemade medicines. They will not go to the doctor, especially in the rural areas. So let's say half of the, maybe 70% population is living in the rural area, which will never go to the hospital. Only 30% is living in urban areas, having some access to the medical facilities. So now after about 2 million, we reduce to 30%. That's about 600,000. Or we were deciding, okay, 2 million into 7 pills, 14 million. 14 million of them, only 30% will be able to access the paracetamol. So that makes it about 4 million, correct? So that's the market potential you are talking about. But this market potential is not only yours. They are competitors. Your competitors, your brands.
As by your community data, how many paracetamol you sold.
Yes.
Yes. Then you can estimate how much of the market.
Yes. You want to achieve. So means that let's say now you can.
From the whole market
is 4 million.
Like 20% of
yes,
the market.
Yes. At the moment. Right. So let's say
you want to expand.
Yeah.
5% or 10%.
5% or 10%. So that means you are forecasting, you are budgeting yourself, right? Forecasting means you will estimate based on your pace where you will reach. But budgeting means you need to decide where you want to reach. So it's the goalpost. Forecasting is to reach, to understand how much we can reach there. So means your market potential is 4 million pills that you can sell in total. So now you will see, okay, how many we sell in the past. If let's say you are able to sell 2 million, means you already have 50% market share. But now you need to budget. Okay, what I want to achieve? Do I want to achieve 60% market share? Do I want to achieve 70% market share? Do I want to achieve 80% market share? What is the market share that I want to achieve? Because your planning, your business activities, your marketing activities, advertisement activities will all depend on what you want to achieve. And then you will strategize how to capture this market. Okay, so that's the market potential. And the sales potential is how much as among a set of competitive firms you can sell. Okay, so that's the set market sales potential, your sales potential. Yes, sir.
In India, you can get this data.
Yes.
Easily.
Yes.
Or will be something.
No, it's not. The data is not available easily anywhere except in Europe or US. In India also, the most of the data is unstructured.
Yes.
I have a class next week on this business intelligence and data mining to understand how we analyze the data. Here also you don't have a data actually.
Yeah. Because
nobody recorded. You have to estimate.
You have to check with the data. Research company.
Yeah. Actually, there are now research companies. They just started.
MMRD.
There is a new startup which is doing the market research. I don't know how much they charge.
They are selling the salary survey.
Yes, they are doing a lot of surveys. They are doing the survey, and anyway, you can actually estimate. Let's say you want to understand the population, you can go to the government and ask what is the population. Correct. You can ask, you can do a sample survey. Instead, if you cannot, because it's very difficult to get the entire country.
Yeah.
Right. The only way is okay, do an informal market survey only in Yangon, and you are doing a sample. So how normally you said, because there are a lot of news channels, lot of companies are saying, or you might be hearing the news, 70% of CEOs need read some book. How they know? Do the survey of entire population? No. They just ask 100 people. And if those out of those sample data, 70 people say, yes, we do this particular thing, then they will generalize it, mean extrapolate it. So what you can do is, instead of doing the entire survey of whole country, what you can do is you can do it from one district, Yankin district, and you will analyze based on that particular location only. Then your market research is very small. You can do the analysis based on this data and extrapolate to other units, but you cannot use this data for rural areas. So you need to do one maybe in rural area, right? Maybe in one in suburban area. So you need to decide what is your sample size, where you're going to do the sample for doing the market research. You can do it by yourself, or you can hire the companies to do it. But it's important to understand the market potential if ever you want to do a sales budget, because that will define what is your market potential, what is your ability to achieve. There is no point in putting up a budget if the market is only 100,000 units and you are making a sales budget of 150,000 units. You will never be able to achieve it. But if the market potential is 100,000, there is no point of doing a budget of 20,000 also, correct? Because you are not estimating your full potential yet. So understanding market potential is quite important. Okay, so the reasons why forecasting is important. So it's important because we want to do a planning. Planning of sales marketing, planning of financial planning, how much will be your P&L, how much will be your budget, what amount, where you want to spend the money on traveling expense, ticketing expense, accommodation expense, meal expense, employee expense, payroll, right? Human resource, hiring people, how many people you need to hire to tap certain market potential. If you say, okay, I want to tap the Mandalay market, then you need to have somebody in Mandalay market, correct? So you need to hire the people there. But hiring decision will depend on, is it the market potential in Mandalay is big enough to support one staff or not, right? So that's how you, otherwise your profit, you may get higher numbers, but your profitability will not increase because you are spending too much. Production scheduling. So you can give that number to the production, because nowadays markets are quite seasonal.
Yes.
They appear in some months there is nothing there. So if you produce too much in those months where there is no demand, you keep high inventory. You can sell in next month, but the inventory cost, the warehousing cost, the storage cost increase, right? And if you are taking money on loan, then your interest cost will also be increased. And then you need capital investment. How will you know how big capacity you need? If you put up the capacity which is smaller, you will not be able to compete a demand. If you put a big factory, then you will have surplus capacity for which you are paying the money on the rental, on the electricity, or everything else, correct? So capital investment is also important. Procurement, how much you need to procure, your supply chain, how many person you need. Do you need your own delivery vehicle, or you can ask the supplier? Because supplier will ask you extra money for delivery, no? But if you have a regular supply, you can ask the supplier, if you can buy your own delivery and say, okay, we will pick up by ourselves, if it's more cost effective. So these are all the factors which is a business, from business point of view, but it's all affected directly by the sales potential, sales market analysis. Inventory management. Okay, impact of erroneous sales forecast. So these are the, if you do wrong forecasting, what will happen on the production? Too high means excess output, unsold products. Too low means inadequate output to demand. Inventory overstocking or understocking. Finance, idle cash or cash shortage. Distribution, costly or inefficient. But if too low, then insufficient expenditure. Sorry, inadequate to reach the market. Pricing, reduced to sell the expensive, right? Excess products. And a price increase to allocate scarce products. So sales force, customer relationships, profits, so all things are affected by wrong sales forecast. But let's say you are a new company launching a brand new project. So how will you do the forecast? You know, you understand your customer behavior from the past trends, right? If you are pharma industry, okay, you know the data in the past. If you are hotel industry, you know the data. But what if there is a new product which is not yet come into the market, nobody has used it? How will you know the sales forecast? Any idea?
Okay, number one, the usage of this product, how it's useful, and then what is the difference with the previous one. Because you think, let's say, you think are very difficult to be master, and but based on the modification or the comedy was with the manufacturer were who make some the bad one and they make the new version that one of them. So we have to do strong by everywhere of this. Then if possible we get the right to the our dealer or something like that.
You do a survey. You do again the survey. You can do the test markets. Sometime like I still remember at one time Coca-Cola wanted to come into the country in India. So they have no idea of market potential. They had no idea the people will like it or not. So what they do, they distributed free sample to just to test out the market. Is it work or doesn't work? And the peoples were crazy about the product because it was free. First thing is all free. Indians are always going after the free things. Even if it's harmful, just take it. Never mind. We deal with the harm later. Yeah, but get the things for free first. So because it was free, people took it and they like it. And then they make it habitual. So they created the need actually. There was no need for soft drinks in India because we have our own soft drinks. But they created the need. They created a desire. And then they start selling it. So then after that, by that time, they knew how much will be the potential market. So they started in one city, okay, 30% of the people are already using it. Now we know what is the extrapolate. Then they will be able to understand what will be the estimate demand. Let's say 30% are using for free, right? So you divide by half or you increase the price and then see how much is the production. Small first. And then you plan your bigger capacities after you understand how much is the market potential. Okay, so the process of planning. What is the planning process? So first we analyze the sales records, if we have the sales record, the past records, and then we develop a preliminary forecast. What will be the future sales depending on the same pace, depending on the market potential, depending on the current existing promotions, what we are doing, what will be the preliminary forecast. And then you have managers to review the forecast and adjust it. It's always adjust upward or downwards. When you make your initial forecast of the sales, the managers are going to increase or decrease?
Increase.
Why they increase?
They always want to increase.
They always want to push you.
Yeah.
Right? So how much is the percentage increase that they want?
Our company this year 45%. Means last year we are not achieving the target. Only 76%. Based on that, they are added this year.
76% into another 40%. Yeah. 40%.
This year maybe 20%. Last year compensation they increase like that. Climate is also always making like that. Very high
target.
No. Some company is realistic. Our company is making like that.
Push. It's called pushing technology. You know, Sam.
They push, but if we are not achieving 6 months, everybody is up.
Oh, okay.
Very serious.
Yeah. So the country manager has to be very smart.
Smart, but like a focused state budget is also. Budget is also very good. They sometimes they can use their brain and
Yeah, of course. It depends on the marketing things because everything is now customer centric. That's why we are saying we make what we sell.
Established 2003. In this period, more than 10 country managers.
Oh, 10 years or 15 years, 10 country managers. So it's a very high turnover.
Yes.
Okay. And then whatever forecast we finalize, we build a sales plan around that one and then we make adjustment to operation plans. So you are adjusting your operational plans, your financial plans based on your sales plan. So I think that the process remains the same across the industries. It doesn't matter which industry you are in. The first thing is the business development plan, sales plan. Then you are updating your operations plan and then finally you are updating your financial plans. Financial plans comes always at the end because it's just a compilation of whatever operations and marketing has been doing. Finance have their own, no expense on their own, right? It's just a compilation. So the characteristics of successful programs means the planning, operational planning programs is the people. So managerial level need to support the process. So the top management has, because some of the companies, how many of you really believe in budget and planning? Really believe means company is asking you to make a budget is different thing. But you think if budgeting is really helpful or not. Some people, most of the managers that I always meet, oh, budget, okay. Last year, plus add 20%, because now we know the manager will add for 30%, right? So we put 20% first. Management will add another 20%, so we make 40%. But that's a paper exercise. Okay, now we know we need to sell something. Okay, that's a paper. And next month, when we achieve, actually, we just compare with the budget and then, okay. Just explain, make some rubbish explanations of why we are not able to achieve the market. Even though you are shocked, then you are explaining, oh, competitor is higher, or these people are not getting sick. You can say in the pharma, right? People don't get sick. So the idea is the process will be successful only if people take it seriously and they understand the value of doing the budget. It's a very tedious process. Doing the budget is not an easy process because it requires a lot of estimates, requires a lot of research into
the
market.
It's based on our production.
Yes.
Like just you say previous line.
Hmm.
In our farm market, this is very important.
Hmm.
If not like that, stock is iron stock, it may be near expiry.
Yes. And then
not exactly stock, it may be.
Other competitor will keep the market.
Yes.
Even though you can say what we were able to sell whatever. Yes. So means the planning need to be better.
Yes.
So that is one thing. And another is the process. What is the process of doing this budget? So normally you have regular meetings and metrics monitor progress and provide the benchmarks. Because means you need to have your correct matrices. What matrices you want to track to achieve your forecast, to achieve your budgets. Not only the sales number is not going to be enough. If you just compile the total sales number, it's not going to be always enough. You need to also see how many, where, what is the distribution channel. So break down the sales into deeper components. And then you will be able to understand your business in a more clearer way. Technology. Do you have the data of doing the forecast? The forecast is a very, very important factor, and the most important factor in doing the forecast or planning is the data. Is the market research, market intelligence, or decision support systems which are in place to assist. So, for example, you said Myanmar doesn't have a structured data, correct? Most of the data is not available, but then you need to do some research.
Regularly, the government issue.
Hmm. They are issuing the statistics report. Yeah, they are doing the reports. They are, World Bank is doing the research. Central Bank is doing the research. And there are nowadays some of the banks are actually doing the research work. And like associations are doing the research work. You can try to get the data from the Chamber of Commerce, the British Chamber of Commerce. These companies are doing, wherever the data you can get, you just need to get it, validate it. But for that, you need to have systems, correct? The data is very important. Market intelligence is very, very important. Then you need to have a strategy, okay? Effective strategy should align the supply or with supply and inventories with the demand. So means if let's say you make a market potential, what is your strategy? You want to go for price, you want to go for value, you want to go for specific market, you want to go for aggressive marketing. What is your strategy? So you need to have a strategy as well. And then your performance measurement. Because if you don't measure your, after you do everything, you're not measuring your performance, it's also useless, right? So you need to define the important metrics. For like technology companies, they want to understand the timeliness. For them, response time is very important. How many escalations they have. Not only the financial performance, not only the revenue and expenses, also the qualitative area of the business, the performance metrics. So the sales plan or the operation plans does not include only the financial numbers, also include the qualitative numbers. How much is your response time? How many escalations you have? what is the customer service feedbacks, right? What is the employee surveys? What are the targets for employee surveys? So every company has a scorecard, balanced score. We call it balanced scorecard. Financial, customer related numbers, employee related numbers, and also your internal process related numbers. Yeah, we have a balanced scorecard. So
can you share
balanced scorecard is like there are four perspectives for balanced scorecard, right? So one is your customer perspective.
Is it really functioning in your?
It's function in hotels, yes. Because I'm not in the current hotel, but it used to work in the Shangri-La. Shangri-La is international chain. So we had defined the characteristics.
Because most of the Myanmar companies, they don't like the balanced scorecard.
Yeah, it's very difficult to implement. And it takes time to implement. It's not that easy to implement a balanced scorecard. First thing is, they don't understand it. And what are the different components and why they are necessary. For second thing, it takes time to develop and strategize on where you want to achieve. For example, in Shangri-La, for customer perspective, we were thinking, okay, what should be your check-in time? We never allow the check-in time more than 5 minutes. So how you are going to achieve actual check-in time? How will you measure you define the metrics is okay, but how will you measure the actual check-in time? There's no measurement, right? It's very difficult to measure. So what we are doing is we ask the customer, in the customer specific surveys, we ask specifically, how was your check-in experience? Was it within 5 minutes? But you cannot ask within 5 minutes. Was it prompt? So we understand from there. And we do the operational audits to understand what is the performance. So we apply the mystery shoppers to do this specific task based on our balance scorecards. And then the properties are ranked upon their audit scores. Then we understand. Okay, our criteria is customer should be checking in 5 minutes, or the drink should arrive in 2 minutes of the order, or 10 minutes of the order. What should be the time for bill settlement? We say, okay, bill settlement should be done within 2 minutes. So customer come, he say he want to check out, within 2 minutes he should be out from the customer. What is the feedback? What is the overall, we call it overall stay experience. How much customer is giving you the score for his overall efficiency? If more than 70% of the customers are saying they are happy, then hotel is doing okay. Less than that, the hotel is not doing okay. So we allow 30% margin and not just only happy. We have like scores, 5 out of 5, 4 out of 5, and 3 out of 5. 3 out of 5 is good. 4 out of 5 is average. We accept only 5 out of 5. That is 60% of your scores has to be 5 out of 5, no compromise. So means you need to understand, how will you tell your customers to give 5 out of 5? Are you going to tell them, please give me 5 out of 5? Cannot, right? So how the customer will give you 5 out of 5 if genuinely you are not top notch? So that's why the Shangri-La's practices and the policies and processes are very super high standard. There's no chance for mistakes. If mistakes happen, your score will go down. And surveys are done independently. So in here, like I asked my hotels to send a survey. So what they are doing is they send the survey only to the happy people. Complaining people, they don't even send a survey. So I have no idea what is happening. I just know only via TripAdvisor. Oh, there's a complaint. So that is, but in that case, your internal processes and your way of doing the business need to be adjusted, because the balance scorecard is very difficult to implement. Okay, estimating the industry and demand. So let's here we see what is implemented. So there are two methods. One is called standardized classification system, and one is called buyer intention. So industry demand approach. So this was developed by, standard classification system was developed by this company, North American Industrial Classification System. And the buyers is the survey potential for industrial customers to measure the purchase intentions and the likelihood to give a purchase. So this is the two different methods. One is a statistical method. Standard classification system is a statistical method, how we estimate. And buyer intention is an unstatistical method. It's just like a rule of thumb. So this North American system was developed by under the Office of Management and Budget and adopted in 1997. It was replaced, it was developed jointly by the US and Mexico's compressory to allow high level of comparability in business statistics. But that is in US, and that was in 1997, like 12 years ago, not now. So the forecast in steps in forecasting sales using a breakdown approach. Did I miss anything? Let's see. Forecast general economic conditions. Then you estimate the industry's total market potential for a particular product category. What is the general economic condition? What are the general economic conditions?
The steady stream of the business.
No, general economic conditions. It doesn't specific to any industry. General economic conditions means your GDP, right? Gross domestic product of Myanmar, inflation, interest rates. These are general economic conditions of the country or of the market wherever you are targeting. So these are general economic conditions. So how these things help you? It doesn't help you in the budgeting and forecasting directly. It will but give you an overall indication what's happening. If let's say the GDP is growing down, right? Or the per capita income is increasing. So what will you assume? But if let's say GDP is going down, means the industry is going towards a slower pace. So demand will not be increasing too much. It doesn't mean that it will not grow. The GDP growth means how much extra produce you are doing. Correct? So even if the GDP increase is growing slowly or is low, it doesn't mean that it's not growing. It's growing, but it's slower. Correct? So means it's going towards a depression. The economy is going towards a depression, means the demand will not increase. So if you are expecting an increase in the sales, you may not be successful. Okay, that's what the general direction. It's a general idea only. But it depends on many factors. Your competitor, you can eat the competitor share to increase your own sales. So means your strategy will be different. If the economy is growing, you can try to achieve new customers, right? Because pie is growing, your cake is growing. But if the cake is not growing, then what do you need to do? You need to grab somebody else's share, right? No, you cannot give it to me. So, but then your business strategy will have to be different. Your marketing strategy will have to be different. Your expenditure on the customers or the target customer will be different also, correct? So your business strategy will differ. Let's say you are saying per capita income is increasing. So what does it tell you? It means the income level in general are increasing in the economy. Means their buying power might be increasing as well. So if you are thinking of increasing the price, it's a good time, correct? But since it's a very general matrix, you cannot apply blindly. It also may mean that inflation is increasing. It also may mean that the people will skip, because in the first class we said, if the consumers income levels are increasing, then their behaviors will change. So you need to see the impact on your product. If let's say your product is suited for lower category, lower income category, and the GDP or the per capita income is growing, so means it's an alarm bell for you that the consumer may switch the category of the product. So you may need to change your product category or launch the higher category versions, right? So these are all the general economic condition, how they affect your business. Then you have industry's total market. In your particular industry, how much is the total market potential? And in that one, how much is your share at the moment and what you want to achieve in the future? And then you forecast the sales potential for that particular product. If you have more than one product, then your share in the market, then multiply by the share of that particular product in your overall share. Correct? And then use the sales forecast to do the operation planning and budgeting. So this is the general breakdown approach. Okay, so this is the top down. So first we do the economic forecast, then we do economic estimate the market potential, and then you do the market sales potential, then your company sales, and then your product sales. And for each product, you will have your sales force, you will have your sales manager composite, you will have your market surveys, right? So these are the two techniques for doing the sales forecast. One is breakdown and one is build up. So build up, breakdown means you will first look at the overall structure, GDP, consumer price index, whole price index, interest rate, unemployment levels, and then you will go towards the market, as we said in, as we discussed in the previous slide, then your industry specific. Bottom up means you do a primary research first and then build up towards the base. So you are understanding the base first, build up or the breakdown. Breakdown is easy to use when you have established market. You can have a data to analyze the previous data. But if it's a new product, then you have to use the built up approach. Okay. Oh, this one we have already discussed. What is GNP, GDP, consumer price index, wholesale price index? We understand, right? The difference between consumer price and wholesale price. Okay. And then the sales forecasting techniques. The sales forecast, there are two type of forecasting techniques. One is non-quantitative and one is quantitative. So what is non-quantitative? Non-quantitative is judgment based and counting methods. Judgment means your forecast, nay forecast. Just assume the next period sales based on the previous time. Last year we sell 10,000, this year we will sell 11. That's nay forecast and that's judgmental. Then you have jury of execution, means you just ask the member of the executives how much you want to sell or how much do you think we can sell. Or you can ask the Salesforce people, how much do you think we can sell based on your market expectations, correct? A lot of companies does this one, Salesforce. They will ask the salespeople, how much do you think we can sell, correct? If let's say, especially when the sales budget is done by the salespeople, then they will say, okay, how much I think I can do, even in my company, it happens like that. But it's very difficult to change. It's just like this, how much I think I can sell, not based on how much we should be able to sell, how much I think we can sell. So that's judgmental. It's not the proper method. Then the counting method means survey of customers buying intention and the test marketing. So this is another non-quantitative method of doing the forecast. But these two forecasts are mostly usable when there is no previous data. Especially the previous data is not available or is available in a way that you cannot use quantitative methods, because quantitative method means statistical methods. You are going to apply the models or this data models to forecast the future. Okay, these are all unbuilt data, unstructured data, or you don't have a previous data.
The first one, it's also based on the previous data, right?
Yes. But is the data is not able to relate, means you are not able to relate the data with any other variable. The quantitative methods are mostly statistical, so they work based on relationship of something. For example, if let's say the last year data is only one variable, how much we sell, but depend on what? Depend on the population, depend on maybe the demand generation, or depend on the some other factors, but there has to be some kind of relationship. So forecasting methods always work based on what is the relationship. Or let's say if you have not been one, because for forecasting by statistical, you need to have at least 2 to 3 years previous year data. But if you don't, let's say you don't have a previous year's trend, or you maybe have a trend, but you just use, because it's easy. Nay forecast is very easy to do, because you just need to look at the trend. Increasing, okay, 10% increase, 5% increase, 7% increase. That's it, another 10% increase.
Like your formula.
Basically. Yeah, just like a easier, right? Easy average the previous year's increase and estimate the future growth. That's easiest way to do the forecast. And that's most of the companies does, because it's the one of the easiest way. And it has the quality of both non-quantitative and quantitative, because this based on figures, but still judgment. Okay. Then you have quantitative. This is a bit more difficult. So I will not go into too deep details, because you may not be able to understand. So So there's a time series method and one is called casual or association method. Okay, so let's say casual. What is a time series? Moving average. You know what is moving average? He may know. You should know because you are from engineering. You didn't study the statistics?
Yes, but
forgot. So what is a moving average? Moving average means the is a average of, you know what is average, right?
Yeah.
So moving average means it's moving. Okay, means like, for example, okay, do we have, then I have to stand up and do a bit of example. Okay, where? This side. Okay, let's say you have year 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Okay, here you have 10, second year 20, third year 20, 30. So what is the average? Calculate. 30.
Average is
30. Are you sure? 50. Ah, that's why I was checking. Okay, 20. Let's say this is 35. So what is the moving average in year 4? So moving average formula says, now you will not average 3 years, 4 years. You will average this 3. And then fifth year, you will average this 3. Let's say 40. And then 45, right? So this fifth, sixth year, you will average this 3. So it will keep on changing. The average will keep on changing. So the later previous years are given no reference because the idea is the previous year has no impact. So the company is making a judgment how many years of the moving average I should be using. 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, depending on how much you think the previous years have an impact on the future years. Okay, so that's the moving average. And then you have exponential smoothing. Difficult to exponential smoothing. What is exponential smoothing? We have more detail about these ones, so we'll explain. Box Jenkins is another way of doing the predictions based on, it was developed by somebody called Box Jenkins. And then you have trend analysis using ARIMA. ARIMA is also one software which is developed by Americans. So that is another trend analysis. And then the casual association means correlation and regression. Have anybody heard of this term? Correlation and regression. That's what I was telling you. I will not go into deep detail, otherwise I will go crazy. So correlation and regression is a statistical work. Okay. It depends. So it just say that it will relate your data with something else, some other variable. Okay, so that your sales will depend on something else. Then you have econometric model and input output model. These are all the data mining models. So the big sales systems or big forecasting systems, they use these techniques, or sometimes they use time series analysis. So trends are the movements in a time series as a result of development in population, technology, or capital formation. So these are called trends. Then you have periodic movements, mixed moves, moving averages, are constant patterns and sales changes in a given period, generally called seasonal variations. Then you have cyclical movements, right? Trend is complete trend. Periodic movements is maybe only every January, or sometime February, sometime March, sometime April. Seasonal means, cyclical means every January to March is very high, and April to September is very low. So that's cyclical. Every cycle is the same, almost the same. And erratic movements means there is no pattern. It just happened at any point of time. It's erratic. Okay, so these are at one time specific events. So these are the different methods, different understanding. What is called trend is always happen normally in the same way. Either it's down or it's up, but it happens over a period of time. Periodic movements are consistent pattern. Cyclical means a wave like, always waves. So the waves will remain the same. Okay, so the moving average is, moving average are forecast developed using a moving average to predict future sales by a mathematical function in the recent time. So as I explained, last 3 months. So every time new increase, we will ignore the previous years. Or sometimes what they do is they will assign some value to the, they assign weights to the value. Exponential smoothing is a type of moving average. It's the same thing, moving average, that represent weighted sum of past. So in this, for example, in this case, if let's say the this year was exponential, too much, maybe 60. So the moving average will depend, right? It will not be affected only 1 year, it will affect 3 years. This year, and so not only 3 years, or this year also, right? 3 years. It affected 3 years. So what you are doing is, and also if you say actually recent year was my best year, the latest, especially when the market is changing very fast. So market is changing very fast means the previous 3 years are not relevant anymore, but maybe relevant only little bit. So what will you do is you will assign them a weight. Okay, I will use 20% weight for this, 30% weight for this, and the rest 50% will be the least risk. You multiply these two together and then do an average. So means you are using not, because this is a straight line, you are giving 1/3 to each, correct? But in this case, you are not giving 1/3. You are defining what should be my correct weight and then giving them the right weights, depending on what is the strategy. But the challenge here is what should be the weight? How you will define this year should be 50%, this year should be 30%, or this year should be 20%. Very difficult, right? Subjective. So this is, even though it's a statistical method, there is a subject, assumptions involved in here. ARIMA is auto-regressive integrated moving average. More complicated. Based on the moving average concept, this model incorporates information about the trends in spotting patterns and fluctuation data. So what it will do is, if let's say it's 100, sometime it will become 100. So your moving average will be affected too much. So it will remove the, it will identify the pattern and it will remove the unusual data. Then moving average is just an example. So here is the average of, here is the example of moving average. Simple moving average means you just add 15%, 5%, 5 median percent. So moving average will be 5%. And then exponential basis means 20% 4 year, 4% for the first year, 6, second and third, 10% in the last year, right? So it means we must do, we can assign the weights 25%, 30% and 45%. So you average it up at 7.3%. So next year it will increase at 7.3%. But it's very technical, statistical method. Correct? You will never apply this. So now you are thinking, actually the name way of forecasting is much better. Okay, then you have correlation and regression analysis. So correlation is causal association method, is attempt to identify the factors affecting results. So for example, your what kind of example I can give you? Maybe let's say for example tourist for hotels. I can easily give you the hotel examples. Other industry is difficult for me. So let's say the, or even the telecom, you can say, okay, number of smartphones versus the data usage. So you can use the correlation, right? How much, how many smartphones sell in the market and how much the data usage, and what, how is it has been moving over month, not year over year, because the market is not very old, month over month. Then you can check what should, if the market, and then you can ask the smartphone dealers how much you think you will be able to sell in the future. Based on that, you can estimate your data usage sale, correct? That's one way. Another way is the, because data usage is not only by a smartphone, it's also by the businesses, correct? So businesses are using the data for what? Internet, sending emails, sending the files. So higher business means higher sending, so means higher use of the data. And then you have something called econometric. It's based on a series of regression equations. So we will not go into the details. So we will probably skip this because it's too complicated. Input-output models are, these are designed by the data mining techniques. There are softwares which are built on top of these technologies. So in real world, nobody does it. Nobody does the correlation analysis, nobody does econometric analysis, nobody does input output model. They are all defined in the system already. They will just ask you the data. What is the data? What has been the last year sales compared to the smartphones? And then the system will automatically calculate the future. They are very smart systems nowadays. Okay, correlation analysis. Oh, again, do you really want to read this? You will get sleepy. So let's skip this one. We don't want to unnecessarily complicate things. So criteria for evaluating forecasting methods. So what method you should use out of this, correct? So one is the comprehensibility. Must understand. Sales person need to understand the basic method. So since we don't understand any of this, so we use NAVE method, correct? NAVE forecasting. Easier, right? What is last year? What is this year? Accuracy. Which method will give you the accuracy, sufficient accuracy over the purpose desired? So if your desire, if your purpose is just only to allocate the sales target for the next year based on your previous data, then it's easier to use whatever target, whatever the easier way. Like maybe some, there are other, not only the NAVE forecast, there are other methods like market research. You can do the customer surveys. Those methods are also available for you to do, but these are subject to errors. If you use the customer survey method, if you use the market research method, because the research and survey are done on a sample. Sample can be maybe 5% or 10% of the total population, maybe not even 5%. So that gives you a very huge margin of error. So if you are doing the production analysis, then you want a better understanding of exact data, what it should be. Otherwise, your capital investment can be very heavy, right? Timeliness, which method will be able to generate the report on time, or what you can finish on time to be able to use them. It should not be that the forecast is taking 10 months for doing the 2020-21 forecast. By the time you finish the forecast, year is also finished. Quality and quantity of the information. So it is something called garbage in, garbage out. The wrong data you give to the forecasting system, the wrong information you will also get, right? So the quality of the data as well is important in evaluating the forecast. Then you have qualification. Do you have enough qualified professionals to do it? Do you have enough time to monitor the actual sales and identify the patterns for doing the forecasting? And what is the cost and benefit of doing the system? There is no point in doing the very heavy forecasting for and apply the systems or expensive softwares for a company which has a sales of only $10,000 in a year. Okay? But if you are selling like expensive items, then you can apply for higher sales. For example, your company, you are selling only a few projects. So you don't need to have a very complicated method of doing the forecast. It's very easy. Forecasting will be more difficult, especially when you are doing the consumer business, where you are involving with hundreds of thousands of customers. Your product is depend on the consumers. And there you need to do a more detailed forecast. For you, it's easy. Just rule of thumb. How many projects are going to come in the market is enough. Simple, right? 10 projects, okay. 10 project is done. Okay, the planning of the sales budget. So the sales budget use the planning function. Planning function means we plan the operational planning process in the financial terms and also provide a guide towards the action. And coordinating function. So it coordinates the results. It coordinates the evaluate the sales against the expectations. And then control. Must be closely integrated with the budget and other marketing activities. And the difference between them is known as budget variance. So here we are doing the planning function. Then we coordinate your marketing activities, your sales activities, and your other promotion activities together as per the plan. And finally, you control them. Compare your actual with the budget. How often you do a sales meeting? Once in a month or once in a quarter?
In general, once in a month. for country-wise
quarter. Once in a quarter. So what do you discuss in the sales monthly sales meeting?
Target and achievement. Then marketing plan.
Compare with the budget?
Yes, compare with the budget. Some QOL ROI, that's also important. And another thing is headquarter wise.
So who does that analysis? You have systems?
Yes, they give the sales headquarter wise sales in our My sales. Based on that.
So you get the data.
Yes.
To do the analysis. Yes. So if the sales target has to be achieved, evaluated every month, so that you can actually do the analysis, right? Okay. Then benefit of preparing an annual sales plan. Annual sales plan means you have a systematic approach to allocate the resources. Develop the sales manager knowledge as well for profitable resource use. And create an awareness of coordinating the sales activity and establish the standard for measuring the performance of sales organization. So you are always measuring your sales organization's performance with a budget. This budget you will actually discern it to your sales people. So how you achieve, how you define, if let's say you have the sales budget of 100,000, how will you design the sales target of individual people based on that 100,000, right?
Based on that 100,000. We have a potential 4 place, Europe, Mandalay, Bologna and Yangon. This is main contribution, the other is less contribution.
So then you will go with individual sales people to identify how much they should be able to sell. Based on how many new accounts they are able to develop. Correct? So that's how you do the sales targets.
When I reach in Glamour, the figure is not the balance. In my Rebexi experience, in for example Taoji, it can sell more, but here it's very less. When I reach in Glamour, I corrected everything. This area can sell that much. That's why target should increase. This area is cannot able to sell that much.
So how you decide based on your experience?
Based on my experience, I propose to the country manager. It should happen like that. It happened like that. The area cannot able to sell. For in case of Hindra, cannot able to sell more than 150 lakh. For me, $8,000.
Because of population.
Because of population, right?
Because of population and market situation.
So you always see the market situation. Correct? You see the competitor or the potential of the market, the buying power or the usage, actual usage of the product. And then you decide.
Most of the district area medical rep sells only one product in our company. It's a very high selling brand, 2 million brand. When I reach, I corrected every product should sell. This product, this product, this product. Power, focus and maintenance brand. Based on that, sales is slowly increased.
So that's
previous at the Banaba of one product and now reach a 9-10 product. Sales also growth.
Just a second. Hello? Yes. I will finish in soon, just in 10 minutes, 15 minutes.
10 minutes. Okay. Okay. Yeah.
Oh my god. I forgot to tell. Oh, sorry. Okay. I will finish in soon. Yeah. Okay, so preparation steps. Oh, it's already there. So the preparation steps in first is the common, the first step is common line items in the budget sales, salary, direct selling expenses. Then you have communication sales goal, communication of your sales goal, and then identify the separate market opportunities and problems for each sales manager. Right, and should they because they need to identify their own market based on their own targets, and then you assign the resources for particular activities, for consumer, for products, for territories, and then you use a budget presentation for your own territory, right? Overall budget presentations, and then you implement the budget. So these are the normal general steps in budget preparation or budget preparation.